celebration of life.
Hello, everybody. I would like to thank the organizers of this SFL conference, especially Dr. Maria Briss, for giving me the honor to address this distinguished audience to share my personal memories of Halliday and Hasan. Thanks to Mariam Gorbia for having put up the montage for you to look at, which you've been seeing. And thank you, Maria and Tom, for some brilliant presentations on Halliday and Hasan. I doubt if I can match it, but I'll give it a try. Would you think that parents have their own discourse and register and code of behavior? One of my fond memories of Halliday and Hasan is the frequent discussion on this topic at their breakfast table, observing a bunch of lorikeets seemingly conversing to each other, waiting on the ledge of the balcony in Manly, while just one pair fed themselves on the sunflower seeds. Observing their behavior, Halliday and Hasan both wondered if the parents were following the social code, waiting for the pair to fly off before coming down to take their pill. I guess we won't ever know. But it was fun listening to their conjectures. Maybe all of you linguists have reflected similarly, but I'm a classroom teacher like you, and so how would I know? I would like to begin by paying homage to them, saying that I am today what I am professionally because of their strong support and mentoring. They not only nurtured me, but in the 80s when I was working with colleagues from Pakistan on founding the Society of Pakistan English Language Teachers, commonly known as SPELT, they gave us insights about aspects to consider in forming a teachers association. They both actively contributed to the plenary SPELT by submitting articles to its journal and presenting at the SPELT conferences. Not only that, they supported SPELT, introducing other presenters like Jeff Williams, Jenny Hammond, Brian Dare, Jane Willis, to name just a few. During his last visit, Halliday especially brought a complete set of his books to present to the SPELT library. Today, SPELT is internationally well-regarded, recognized as a leading teacher association in South Asia. In a country like Pakistan, which focuses on atom bombs instead of education, language versus literacy controversy hasn't yet settled. So applied linguistics and ELT are both struggling to get a legitimate place in Pakistani system of education. SPELT survivors of 34 years under these conditions owes much to Halliday and Hasan and all friends who contributed to their phenomenal success. Their support for SPELT continues even today when they are no longer with us physically. Their love for SPELT is reflected in the course which SPELTers are doing currently, entitled Introduction to SFL for Pakistani Teachers. Appa has been working on this course for several years. Visiting them in Hong Kong and Sydney, I was a witness to discussions she and Michael had about the content and the level of instruction for Pakistani teachers who have very little background in applied linguistics. They were often so engrossed that discussions continued while washing, drying dishes, cleaning up. This mode of Halliday Hasan discussion I observed whenever I visited them, wherever they were based in the world. They both loved language analysis and the inherent issues involved. I marveled at their passion and amicable way in which they continued their discourse without raised voices or any visible irritation. I must admit, though, that very often the discussion was beyond my comprehension. One of the greatest regrets in life, in my life, is that I chose to do the TEFL instead of applied linguistics from Sydney University, then thus having lost the opportunity of being formally taught by either of them. Though I firmly believe in the functionality of language and consider knowledge of how language works is extremely important for teachers. I have been afraid of grammar and the rigors of analysis. Knowing my sister, I was afraid that I won't be able to maintain the standards she would expect. Like Tom said to me yesterday, she demanded high performance from others. But then, to be fair, she was just as hard on herself when it came to academic inquiry because she was a perfectionist. Anyway, Hasan had finalized the online course for Pakistani teachers and was looking for one more Sydney-based tutor to work with her when she passed away. She loved Pakistan and wanted to do something substantial to introduce SFL to Pakistani teachers. Honoring her wish, Dr. Kamal Cloran volunteered to do this course. She consulted Halliday about the outline of the course and gave it shape and to Hasan's concept. With his blessings, this course started in 2016, entitled Ruqaiya Hasan Memorial Course, Introduction to Systemic Functional Linguistics. It is now in its second phase. The course also has the support of the of SFLA, especially Brian Dare. Additionally, Dr. Jonathan Webster from the Halliday Center in the City University of Hong Kong came forward with further facilitation, and Halliday Center provided web hosting to Dr. Cloran's lectures and teaching materials, without which the course would not have taken place. Teachers enrolled for the course say that their horizons have widened and their perspectives have deepened to look at language as a meaning potential instead of a senseless set of rules. On a personal level, going down the memory lane, though I am now 79 years old, wow, even now I think of myself as Hasan's kid sister, and I call her Appa, which means elder sister in Urdu. Mm-hmm. In our culture, we never call our older siblings by their names without adding to their respectful relationship. Besides two elder brothers, she was my only sister, and I always called her Appa. Although just about 7 years older than me, she was more like a mother to me because I remember her taking care of me, giving me birthday presents of things I coveted, sewing my pretty frocks, dressing me up since my mother was not in good health. We went to the same school. She always had a brilliant track record, especially at math. And my teacher always shamed me for not doing just as well as she did. As theories of psychology go, I should have hated her for putting me in such a bad light. But she loved me so much that I always looked up to her for guidance and love. Appa always did so well in her studies and was so passionate about learning that my aunts persuaded my parents to let her continue her studies instead of marrying her off after she had passed the 10th grade. She was the first girl from her family to go to another city to study. Appa went to Allahabad University to do a BA and still remember the pride we felt when she got the Dunn Gold Medal for English language. My eldest brother Zawar Hasan deserves credit for this achievement of hers. When she was in school, he encouraged her to read the classics in English literature, write summaries, and also identify favorite characters, giving justification for her choice. As a teenager, she was already on her way to analysis and critical thinking. There was a break in her education as we migrated to Pakistan in 1954, but focused on her studies, she completed her master's in English literature from Government College Lahore. In 1959, she joined a girls' college to teach English and became aware of the issues of teaching English. That's when she took up linguistics and went to Edinburgh to do her PhD and under Michael's supervision. She was again the first woman from her family to go abroad for her PhD. Other cousins, inspired by her, followed her footsteps. Appa was also the first to marry a foreigner. Our family welcomed Michael Halliday with open arms. My mother did not speak English, but Michael, while visiting, spent time with her every day, with one of us translating for them. My father had long discussions with him, and we all adored his quiet and gentle manner. When we went to a family dinner to a Chinese restaurant, we were surprised to hear him speak Chinese so fluently and order delicious delicacies that we had never known before. Of course, the Chinese owner gave us preferential treatment then and afterwards. And Michael told him that all the countries that he had visited, Chinese food in Pakistani's cuisine was the best. Both Appa and Michael were fond of music, Western as well as Eastern. Appa wanted to learn sitar, so a guru used to come to our house to give her practice whenever she was visiting. He used the Indo-Pakistani drum tabla to give her it. I can never forget how Michael learned to play the teen tal, the 16 beats of tabla within minutes when the musician explained how the tabla works. The guru was also amazed to see how quickly Michael picked up the beats. Mm-hmm. He spent delightful hours listening to classical music of both cultures. Michael had a very musical voice. I have memories of Michael's lovely voice singing to their son Neil as a small child. Five little deep ducks went out one day over the hills and far away. And very often Michael stumbled against it and went to sleep. In all parts of the world they lived, Michael and Neil had a special room with train stations set up and both played there for endless hours. In 1992, when I was doing MIT Sol from University of Leeds, that was the year that Michael was working on a project in UK at Birmingham University. Michael had spent his time in Leeds visiting me on a lovely sunny Sunday. He took me for a long walk and a picnic, walking past his favorite baths in the outskirts of Leeds. He told me the names of flowers and pointed out the birds which we had seen and heard. And whatever knowledge I have of birds and trees is from Hasan and Halliday. Listening to many of Michael's conference presentations and lectures, I've always marveled at how effortlessly he clarified complex concepts in very clear and concise manner. I also had the privilege of a one-to-one instruction from him on phonetics when I stayed with him while doing my dictaphone from Sydney University. I was able to do it with process transcription within days, and I'm proud to say that he was pleased with me. Because I was Appa's kid sister, he also loved me as much as she did, and in his quiet, thoughtful days, he was always there. When I first reached Sydney for my year-long stay, Appa used to go off to work, but Michael at times worked from home. I knew he had tea at 11 a.m. Though I'm not a tea or a coffee drinker myself, I made tea for him and took it to his study. I did the same the next day. The third day, Michael came out of the study as the tea kettle whistled and said, "Zakku, if you want to make tea, let me show you how to make tea." And showed me how to warm the cup.